Just because I love you, it don't mean I trust you. Everybody not to be trusted. Everybody around me thugging. Everybody around me drugging. Everybody around me hustling. Everybody know not to bring no new rigging around me. They say I be bugging. Got racks in the go yard luggage. Just because I love you, it don't mean I trust you. Everybody not to be trusted.
What's up, everybody? Welcome to the show. I'm your host, Quentin Flores, and this is another episode of Uncut with Q, where we talk about all things business, entrepreneurship, and overcoming hardships. Bunch of badass shit. We be talking about a lot of things on the podcast. This is your first time listening to the podcast. We have multiple different types of shows. It's very simple, guys. We do Q&As. You guys can go to www.quintinflores.com/askq. Submit your questions there. We'll answer them here on the show. We also got what we call Mindset with Mitzi, where me and my friend Mitzi, we come in through. We do like crazy psychological stuff. And so if you guys are into energy, vibration, or even just understanding how your brain works, Mitzi's certified 3 different times. Fucking, I don't know what kind of certification she has, but I know that she's fucking insane. And she's gone to like crazy retreats to get certified. So it's pretty awesome having her on the show. And we also have where I bring on a special guest. And there's a bunch of other shows, but for the most part, this is going to be that type of show. And so, guys, before the show begins, I always ask, this is your first time listening, share the show. We turn down sponsorships and advertisements all the time. We're top 1% in the world when it comes to entrepreneurship. You know, probably got over 1,000, 1,200 plus reviews across the spectrum on what it is that we do at Unco with Q. And we want to keep the show going, man. And so you guys keep it alive. You keep it alive by sharing the shit out of this show. All right. So if you get value from this, gain a new perspective, XYZ, tell a friend about what we got going on, tell them about Uncut with Q, and make sure that they subscribe as well, all right? And so with that being said, we're going to dive straight into this, man. Today I have an amazing guest. Go on ahead and introduce yourself to the world, my friend.
Yeah, so name's Josh. Currently, I own or had a moving company here in San Antonio. Had it for over 6 months, started with $500. I sold it in January, and we were making over 6 figures. And then I started another one called Wash Bros Detailing. Did that here for a bit. Currently no longer doing that. And right now I am a operations manager for some commercial real estate.
That's amazing, man. Bro, how old are you? You look really young.
Yeah, I'm 22.
Okay, dang, yeah. 22. Yeah,
22.
22 and already sold your first business.
Yeah.
Now you're operating a full-blown, like what, you said commercial real estate company?
That's just one of the things I do. I also have an e-commerce store that I just started up where I sell mattress protectors, sheets, glasses, stuff like that.
Dude, I think that's amazing that you're like getting real deep into the entrepreneurship realm. At 22, I didn't have the business mindset. You know what I'm saying? I want to ask you a couple questions in regards to that, Josh. First and foremost, congratulations on everything that you've been able to accomplish.
Thank you.
In such a short period of time. What do your friends in high school think about what you're doing?
I don't know. I'm not really on social media too much, so maybe they don't even know. But yeah, I mean, I married my high school sweetheart anyways.
Wow.
So I brought her with me. And my high school's all in Albuquerque, New Mexico. That's where I'm like from, raised there. So don't have a lot of high school people over here. I've only been in San Antonio for about 2 years now.
I see. So like, dude, when you were growing up, did you always have like a business entrepreneurship mindset, or like how did that even come about?
I feel like it's pretty common for most people to say that they didn't.
Yeah.
For me, a little bit about myself is when I was about 5 years old, I came from a really well-off family. We had a mansion, actually.
Wow.
We had 2 backyards. We had a pool, a brand new Jaguar, a BMW in the driveway. And then my parents divorced. So we went from a mansion with all these nice cars in the driveway to a trailer park in the dirt. And my mom working 3 jobs with no child support. And I'm the youngest of 3. So she was working 3 jobs to support 3 of us at the same time.
Wow.
So shout out to my mom, because she is solid. But I mean, from the age of 5 till about where I'm at now, if you want, I can go into that a little
bit. Going ahead. Yeah, this is awesome.
Okay, so when I was about 5 years old, you know, we had all that. They split up. We went to a trailer park. We went from all this nice stuff, having everything, dirt bikes, all this cool shit, to nothing. And it was a rough couple of years. I would say until I was about 16, it was just utter poverty, like the dirt, the basement. And when I say that, I mean like I didn't have my mom around. My dad was not in the picture. It was full custody for my mom. My father was an alcoholic, never saw him, didn't pay child support. And my mom raising 3 kids, 2 brothers. I have an older brother who's 8 years older than me. He was addicted to heroin at the time for 10 years.
Man.
Yeah, so in that house, when we first moved in that to that trailer park, When I was 9 years old, my brother overdosed in front of me. And yeah, no, I'm kind of going deep, but no, I figured why not, man. Let people know kind of where I come from.
I think this is real, bro. And, you know, just the fact that you're even being strong enough to say this right now, it's hard, bro. So, like, keep it up, brother. You good.
All
right. Ain't nobody going to judge you for any of this stuff, man.
But my brother was, yeah, he overdosed. He went to a party. He was addicted to heroin. So he came home, started vomiting in his sleep, you know, choked on his own vomit, was dead for 6 minutes. They had him in a gurney. They had his heart ripped, you know, shirt ripped open. They had the defibrillators. They called time of death.
Wow.
And, you know, call it God. I'm a firm believer in God. And my family started praying for him, my mom, my uncles. And magically, he just took a deep breath. And he, like, sat up right there on the gurney in our room. And, you know, usually after 6 minutes of your heart stopping, you're supposed to be brain dead. Luckily, he's fully functional. And a month later from that, I got hit by lightning, believe it or not.
What the fuck?
Yeah.
How the hell does that happen, man?
So I got home from school. I got on my dirt bike. I was going to go meet for a friend outside. And while I was waiting there, it wasn't raining or anything. It was just like a light sprinkle. And next thing you know, I had like a flashlight. Boom. And I got flown across the street. Hair caught on fire. It melted like the thick dirt bike goggles. Flew across the street. Some dude driving by actually found me on the ground with my head in the dirt. And then he called the ambulance. And luckily, my neighbor was a surgeon. So he came out. And he was like, okay, he's not going to make it. We need to call a helicopter. So I got airlifted to the hospital. I was in the hospital for 3 days, roughly 2 days. I was like unconscious in a coma. And I woke up with like a little, you know, light in my eye. And I had to have two reconstructive surgeries on my eye and my ear. So I'm actually blind out of my right eye and my ear.
Oh my God.
Yeah. And then.
Dude.
So you imagine my mom.
Like, talk about working three jobs. One kid is going through drug addiction. The other one is getting struck by lightning. It's like, fuck, bro.
Yeah.
That's intense, man. And you know what? I think that she's a strong woman for sticking it out and seeing you guys go as far as y'all have been able to go. I mean, I don't know what your brother's condition is like now.
Oh, man.
But
he's making six figures. He moved down here in Austin. He's a manager now. Dude, he did so much better. He turned his whole life around.
That's beautiful, man.
Yeah.
And this is your big brother?
Yeah, he's my big brother.
That's awesome, 8 years dude. On me. And so, like, after doing the lightning and all this stuff, man, like, where does this story go?
Yeah, so from there, we go homeless.
Holy shit.
Yeah, so my mom was in an in-between phase of getting jobs, and, you know, she lost her job or something, and we were moving to a different city, not that far, like 30 minutes or whatever.
Yeah.
And in between that, she lost the house that we were in, and she couldn't find a place to stay. So luckily, we had a friend from our church. He's like, look, like, I don't have a place for you guys to stay, but I have a backyard. So he let us sleep in this like 1990s tow hitch camper, super small. It was my brother had moved out by this point. So it was me, my sister, and my mom, and we were sleeping in this camper with no running water, no heat, no electricity, and we were there for about 2 years. After that, my mom went and finally was able to have enough money to buy a house or rent a house. It turns out we got scammed. This dude rented a house out to us without the permission of the owners. So we got stuck in this weird limbo phase with the courts.
Shit.
Long story short, though, we ended up in this house majority of my middle school years in with no running water. So we used to have to take showers outside with buckets in the rain. And we used to run up to the Circle K up by our house and get like those 5 gallon jugs for like a dollar.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's how we used to take showers.
Dang.
For years. And then from there we got into an apartment, and now this is about the time when I was about 15 now. We had an apartment now, and keep in mind this entire time I haven't had a mattress. I'm sleeping on the couch in the living room.
Hey man, the couch is good living.
It's not too bad. It was okay, but I had a friend come over, he broke it, so it wasn't horrible. Like I'm saying all the bad stuff, but in reality I had a lot of fun. My mom always had really good spirits, you know. She was always happy. She genuinely had like a real sense of joy about her,
you know. Man, to like go, like, I think that people ask me this question all the time, Josh, and they always say, Q, if you can go back in time, what would you do differently on your business journey, on your entrepreneurship journey, on your fitness journey? And my answer is always the same, and it's amazing because you're doing this right now while you're on the podcast. Yeah. I wish I would have gone back. Like, if I could go back, I wish I would have enjoyed those hard times a little bit more, man. Because truthfully, I still had people in my life that I loved that were alive and well. And even though things may have been tough in the beginning, even for me, like, you have a very, very interesting story so far. And as I'm like, as we're progressing through it and seeing how you've been able to struggle, we actually have a lot in common. Mm-hmm. You know, my lightning was my abusive father. My father used to beat the crap out of me, torture me and my brothers and sisters. When I say torture, I mean like literally torture, brother. And so like, not like an abusive dad where you just get a few pow pows. No, man, like we got hit with things all the time. And like, till we were bleeding and in the hospital with broken bones, it was difficult, you know? And so like, when I look back on those hard times and then I compare them to the times that I have now, like now I have $10 million problems. Mm. Back then I had different types of problems, but they're nothing compared to the problems that I have now. And so when I look back at where I was at in the beginning of my journey and all those times I was broke, all those times I was sleeping on couches when I didn't know where I was going to sleep, I even used to sleep in laundromats, man. I used to take a bath inside of the restrooms of Jack in the Boxes because I didn't know where else to go. And I'd use hand soap to wash myself because I couldn't afford shampoo or conditioner. I know exactly what it's like to start from nothing and exactly what you've gone through in a different type of realm, the different type of time. And so when I look back on it, man, I just wish if I could do anything again, I could just really take a moment to enjoy all that bad shit that happened, because it made me who I am today and who I'm very proud to be today, because I have amazing people in my life, amazing mentors in my life, amazing employees in my life, amazing business partners in my life. I have an amazing relationship with God, with my wife, with my son. I got a lot of great things happening right now, but I wish when I was going through those things, I was just taking a lot more time to appreciate the journey, because it's in the journey that you find yourself and who it is that you want to become, you know? And your journey's still being written. The fact that you've done so much already by the time that you're 22, I think that you had to grow up pretty fast doing what you were doing, you know? So you're 15, 16.
Yeah.
Now you're like getting to a point, you're not sleeping on no mattress. You're at least on a couch now. So where are we at now?
Yeah, so in high school, some of the guys in my class were complaining about their rooms or something with their bed. And I was like, man, I'm sleeping on the couch right now, bro. And they started laughing. And then the teacher is like, without saying a word to me, the teacher, like a week later, she actually came to my house and purchased a mattress for me and set it up for me. So I realized throughout my life, I've had a lot of people that were really helpful and really loving.
It's beautiful.
So it's all, like you said, man, there's like, you got to enjoy the journey.
Yeah.
I had a lot of good friends too at the time, too. It was a fun time, even though we had a lot of difficulties. But around that time, I started really like focusing about money. About when I was 12 years old is when I really started focusing on money, because I saw my mom struggle so much. Mm-hmm. You know, we'd have a car breakdown and I had to push it up a hill or whatever. And I was like, Mom, why can't we just buy another car? You know, she didn't have money for it. And so I learned how to become a mechanic, basically learned how to do all the things that she had to pay for so that she wouldn't have to worry about it. So I started working. I learned how to renovate houses. I learned how to, do landscaping, work on vehicles, became a mechanic, all the things that, you know, a husband normally would do for the wife. But since we didn't have a dad there, my brother was off doing his own thing at the time. You know, I had to learn all these different skills. And so about 12 years old, I got my first job. I was working at a church. My mom used to clean this church on the weekends, Saturdays and Sundays. I'd get $20 every time I helped her out. So I'd make $40 a week. And then I started saving up all my money, all of it, over and over and over again. And then my mom's like, Josh, like, I haven't even paid you yet. How much do I owe you? I was like, you owe me $400. She's like,
oh my God.
She's like, what? She's like, yeah. He's like, okay. So my mom hustled a little extra because, you know, she's been spending the money. And then she gave me the full $400. I bought my first, you know, Xbox 360. I had an iPod that my friend gave me. I had all my clothes that were hand-me-downs from my older brother and my cousins, and then, you know, thrift stores and all kinds of cool stuff.
But oh yeah.
So 12 years old, I started building up that, you know, that mentality of saving money. And then as soon as I turned 16, the next month after I turned 16, I knew I needed a job. So I went and I started applying at places, and I had to find something close by because my mom had to work, so she couldn't drop me off. Mm-hmm. So luckily I found a pizzeria that was 5 minutes away from my house, and so I could walk there every morning. And this is all while I was still in high school. So I was going to school full-time and working a full-time 40-hour job at a pizzeria. And at this pizzeria, I saved up all those first checks over and over and over. I kept saving it. I bought my first car for $1,500 from a guy who was in the repossession business. He repossessed this car. He's like, you got it from some drug dealer. It's a beat up 2000 Grand Am with like a messed up paint job with 150,000 miles. And once I got that car, it really opened up a lot of doorways. I started, you know, getting different jobs. And I started asking all my people at my work, because they're like 30, right? They're way ahead of me, in my opinion. I'm like some 16-year-old kid. Here's these 30-year-olds, and they're paying all their bills, and they have decent cars outside. I'm like, you guys work here? Like, this is it? Like, I make $9 an hour. Like, how are you guys surviving off this? And they were somehow, you know, they were making it happen, but I was like, this is not for me. Like, I do not want to be struggling.
He said, this is for the birds.
Yeah, so I started talking to my manager about that, and he's like, Josh, like, you could do it. Like, he kind of gave me that little extra inspiration. Even though he had been working at McDonald's for 10 years of his life, he still gave me that motivation to, like, keep going. And so I guess from that point on, I really just started going from there and saving money. And I guess the next best thing after that was after saving all this money up and getting better jobs, I became salesman. I remember my first sales job was pretty sketchy. I worked at a small furniture store. The dude taught me how to sell because I was really timid at first, right? Kind of shy, more soft-spoken. And so he played a 50 cent on a microphone, and he's all, Josh, if I can't hear you introduce yourself over this microphone, like you can't sell nobody. And I started learning how to sell. I started selling cars. I started selling mattresses. I started like trying to flip things. And I started watching YouTube videos, started learning as much as I want, like as I could. A guy named Graham Stephan, real big entrepreneur guy.
I love Graham, yeah.
I started learning a lot from him about real estate.
I got a chance to meet Graham at a convention in Dallas. It's a really humble dude. Yeah. He's good friends with my other friend, Ryan Pineda. They do videos together all the time.
He seems like a real, like, relaxed.
Oh, super,
dude.
Bro. Super. Yeah. I mean, this is like a prime definition of a guy who wrote the algorithm of YouTube finance. You know what I mean? There wasn't a lot of videos on the internet, bro, about making money on YouTube until like 2018, 2017, that's when that growth spurt started happening on the platform. Mm-hmm. It was like, if I want to learn a hustle, like how to make money, like how to flip houses without using money, YouTube was the game, man. So yeah dude, Graham, phenomenal dude.
I learned everything that I know now was from him. It was just about, you know, I would watch it literally rigorously. I'd come home from school or after work, and I would just watch his videos for hours. Instead of playing video games, I was like, I'm gonna learn something. So I would sit there every day watching all his news videos that come out, him and all these other people that were learning, you know, because like you said, it started blowing up around that time.
Yeah.
And I was like when I was 16 or 17, 2017. So
beautiful, man.
Born in 2000. So I learned all this stuff. And then finally, my mom bought her first house. She saved up or built up her credit score, bought her first house for $90,000.
Congratulations to your mom, bro. She deserves that.
Yeah. $500 down somehow, which is insane. It was a crack house. Don't get me wrong, though. It was a full-blown crack house, messed up carpets. We had a shower door, right? Like those really flimsy ones
for our back door. Those are terrible.
Yeah, we had that for our back door. So every time it got windy, it'd knock out, and I'd have to wake up at like 3 a.m. and go pick it up, put it in. But we bought that house for $90,000, and it was like a beat-up piece of shit. And over time, you know, like I said, I had to learn all these skills. So I tore out all the carpet. I sanded all the floors, painted all the floors, painted the walls with her. We redid the entire kitchen. We did all the appliances, new tile, everything. Like the bathrooms, everything was finished. She sold that about 2 or 3 years ago for $160,000.
Dang, that's a flip, man. Yeah, way to go.
She made a full flip. Rolled that into her next house that she bought for $150,000. She paid off all her cars, got herself a nice car, paid off everything, and then used the money from that for a down payment. And then
and your mom, she ain't never flipped real estate before. Like, this wasn't something that she was like, I mean, did she pick that up from you, or did she just like, I bought it for cheap already, we might as well try to sell it and see if we make money? Is like, was it, did it happen on accident?
A little bit. Another thing is, my mom's a hustler.
Yeah, I can tell. Yeah.
And she gets that from my grandma. My grandma is a landlord in Mexico.
Wow.
Now, my thing about my mom is, my mom is a immigrant from Mexico. She's born in Mexicali, Mexico. Didn't know a single word of English until she was 20. Mm-hmm. Married an American, you know, and then we went from there. But she always had that little hustle in her. You know,
yeah.
Especially coming from Mexico, she came here, it was like opportunity. So,
man, see, moms, bro, like, they're built different if they were born, like, I'm telling, like, I don't know how old your mother is, but if there's one thing I'll tell you,
52.
Man, yeah, my mother's 55. Yeah. She was 56. She just turned 56 3 days ago. Bro, they just built different, dude. My mom was an orphan, and I'm one of six kids. And so she was like working crazy jobs, trying to figure out a way to provide for us, man. And so, bro, like for all my mothers in the building that are listening to this, that are like in the hustle and the grind of things, man, struggle don't last always. Just like Josh's mom and my mom, even my mother got an amazing job. I retired my mom years ago, but she still chooses to work. But I pay my mom $5,000 a month. And that's something that I've stuck with for the last 5 years. She don't have to work, but she loves to work. And so she got like an amazing opportunity being a property management for like a big commercial company. So it's like, you know, it's amazing to think about these things, man. But like most of those moms that were like going through the 90s and whatnot, going through the early 2000s as single mothers and shit, like, dude, they just build different, bro. Yeah. And like they just get it done, dude. So kudos to the women out there with multiple kids that are just getting it done, regardless of the circumstances or situation, dude. Just like your mother. And shout out to Josh's mom for just holding that shit down.
Yes, most definitely, man. She's a hustler, dude. Like, for real. Like, she had it ingrained in her DNA, you know?
Would you say that your father raised you at all?
No.
So 100%?
I haven't even seen him in probably 15 years.
Wow.
Yeah.
Damn. It, like, so your mom pretty much was the staple of, like, mm-hmm. who I'm looking at right now. Like, the yeah. person that you are today, your mom really had some big contributions to that.
And my brother.
And your brother, yeah. I think that it's amazing, man. You know, and like now, like progressing into like the entrepreneurship journey, when did the idea of starting a business even come about after going through all this shit?
Yeah. So I started smoking a lot of weed.
And I know how that is, man. Yeah, yeah.
I got real paranoid, right? And I was like, man, my life every day is like ticking. So I locked myself in my room for like a month probably, and I got like a notebook and I started writing out my entire life about what I wanted. I wanted 100 units. I wanted to make $1.2 million a year. I wanted to retire my mom, pay her that check every month because she doesn't have a retirement. She doesn't have Social Security.
Wow.
So somebody has to retire, mm-hmm. and I figured, why not me? So from that point on, I kind of, you know, started building up my credit score. I got my first credit cards. As soon as I got a job, I built up as many credit cards as I could from Graham Stephan so I could have a good credit score. You know, 700 when I was like 17, I had a 700 credit score. And so I started doing all this stuff, and I started working for people because I was trying to get a down payment on a duplex. I get my first property underway. And I was working for a moving company, two men in a truck, you know, because during COVID, everything shut down. That was an essential business. So I started working for them. And I ended up transferring there from New Mexico because I was like, man, there's not really much here for me. So I transferred here to San Antonio because I figured more opportunity. And as soon as I transferred here, I worked at the moving company for 6 months. And I was like, man, why don't I just do this stuff? Like, they're charging $300 or $200 an hour, whatever it was. And I could do it for way less than that and make probably, you know, twice as much as they're making because I don't have all the overhead. And so I got a group of guys. We all went out to get drinks. We got really drunk and we're like, all right, let's start a business. And they're like, not like, you know, they're all like, fuck this job. This job sucks. And then I was like, all right, well, let's actually do it. And one guy's like, all right, let's do it. Like, he was down. So his name was Santiago. He went with me. And we started this business.
Dude, it's always a Santiago, bro. I've started businesses with a Santiago before. One of these guys, random stuff. And I don't mean to interrupt you because this is getting insane. But I used to flip Magic cards, Magic the Gathering and Yu-Gi-Oh and Pokemon cards. The guy that I met at a freaking card convention, his name was Santiago. And he's actually, he was top five in the regional championships for Yu-Gi-Oh, which is pretty insane. But I had just got bored with life for a minute and I was already making good money. So for me, I wanted to get back into a card game that I used to religiously play. And so, you know, I picked up Magic, went to a regional. It was the wrong night. It was Thursday, not Friday. And so like I went on Friday, and the regional championship for Magic the Gathering was the day before. And it was a Yu-Gi-Oh tournament that was going down. And this was at a convention in Dallas, bro, is huge. And I'm 27 years old. I just made my first $1 million. And this was like 7 years ago. And so like going in and looking at that, I was just like blown away, you know, cause like I'm just at this convention by myself. I don't know anybody. Cause I stopped playing this card game when I was younger. And I run into a guy named Santiago who asked me if I'd be willing to practice game with him. And he and I linked up. He told me about, like, he pulled out a binder, showed me all these pricings for cards, showed me how cards fluctuate in value. Like literally, like a new set will come out, they'll make old cars new, and new cars are irrelevant anymore if you're playing like the standard version. But bro, like on Magic, I was clearing like $3,000-$4,000 in profit a month. Damn. As a side hobby. And it was funding my entire real estate business. I was using my Magic cards to do that. And it was a guy named Santiago. So
That's pretty cool.
Yeah, and dude's name Santiago, bro. If your name's Santiago, you're listening to this, yeah, hustle, baby. Anyway.
Major shout out, man.
So you and this guy went in on creating a moving truck business?
Yeah.
Dang. And how did it go?
Yeah, so I started out with like $500. I didn't know what I was doing at all. So I got an LLC on like Zen Business. I just looked up LLC. How did you do this? And then I figured it out, filed everything. And then I just started going all in on it, learning everything about digital marketing, physical marketing. I went and made business cards, flyers. I went around door knocking with all these business cards, handed them out. I called up all the realtors that I knew because I was like, well, these people probably move a lot. So I called them up. And then I got some real estate people involved in it. And then I really blew it up on Google, though. Like, if you look up Speedy Garcia's Moving, that's the company name. You'll see it. It pops up like 10 times. And that's because I got a contract with U-Haul. You'll see I'm listed everywhere.
Speedy Garcia Moving. I'm looking this up right now. Speedy Garcia's Moving?
That's it.
Wow. 5-star rating.
And they got a bad review after I sold it, okay? It used to be all 5 stars.
I still see 5. On Yelp, it's 4.5. But, you know, that's just Yelp, bro. Yelp. Only losers leave reviews on Yelp. I see a photo of you here, too, with a package in your hand.
Yeah. I did that in New Mexico. I had a friend. I was like, dude, I needed some new photos for my website. I was like, let's go outside. So I just took some old boxes that he had and took that. It looked pretty good, so.
So you built the business up with Santiago. You guys were partners through the whole thing. And then y'all came to a decision to sell the business.
Yeah.
It took y'all
I sold it to him.
Oh, he sold it to him.
He's still the current owner, yeah.
So you paid $500 for this business to get it going.
Yeah.
What did you sell it for?
Oh, I don't want to disclose that.
Oh, no, you're good. You're good. But was it profitable is what I want to ask.
Definitely profitable. Over like, I don't know, 500% profitable.
Shit. See, there you go, like, man.
I don't know what the number is, but yeah.
I still think that that's impressive to sell a business off by the time you're like 20, 21, 22, bro. It's just, it's not like something that you hear all the time. I mean, I think that you're supposed to be maturing. Most guys that I know that are like 21, 22, 23, they're still going to parties. They're still infatuated with banging as many women as they possibly can. And it just seems like you're aligned more with what you have going on. Plus, you're married already. So it's like, dude, I mean.
Two daughters.
And you got 2 kids.
Yeah, 2 daughters. Jesus. I had my first kid when I was, I found out I was having my first kid when I was 18.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, there's more incentive to grow up fast, man.
Yeah.
And so you sold off the moving business. Santiago bought you out of the company. Yeah. Where is your life at now?
Yeah. So as part of the sale for the moving company, I took the biggest lines. And we had a guy in San Antonio that was probably by far the wealthiest guy I've met in San Antonio. I mean, this guy had a $7 million penthouse in downtown San Antonio.
Wow.
We sold it to Popovich.
That's awesome.
Yeah, and it was a giant mansion. It was like 20,000 square feet. And me and him hit it off really good, though, because I started asking him. I'm like, man, how do you have all this money? Like, what do you do for a living? And, you know, he'd like tell me all this crazy stuff. And he was really fun to hang out with. And so me and him really hit it off. And he has the commercial real estate in downtown next to the Pearl, 102 West Josephine, that we're turning into a place called Left Bank Market.
Beautiful area, man.
Yeah. And it's right there on the river, too, the location that we have. And so eventually we're going to turn it into a restaurant business. And then once we have that for a couple of years, we'll turn it into a 10-story building in the future. But I met him, me and him really hit it off. And then from that point on, he had just fired his operations manager and I had just sold my business. And so I was like, hey man, like, you have an inventory problem. You just fired this guy. I know how to run a business. I was all like, just bring me on. He's like, okay, sounds good. And so ever since then, I've just been working with him on that.
I think that's amazing, man. What a freaking journey, Josh. Yeah. Like, dude, I mean, you've been following me and showing me love on Facebook, on Instagram for such a long time. Yeah. And I had no idea, man. And I think that this is so amazing, bro. Like, I'm just blown away. The fact that you can get struck by lightning, witness something very traumatic, like, I mean, watching your mother struggle and then watching your brother overdose and die and now come back. It's like, I just think that God has his hands on your life so heavily right now, brother. And you're already married with 2 kids.
Yeah.
Like, and you got this big opportunity right now building business with like a really wealthy guy here in town. I mean, dude, what would you say was the like, what do you say, like, what would you say was the mindset shift that had to happen for this version of Josh to show up? Because, I mean, think about where you're at when you were living in poverty, like being dirt poor, from going to a mansion, now dirt poor, right? There was a different Josh that existed in that time frame, man. So what do you think was the pivotal moment when you were like, I'm waking up now, this is how I never want to be, this is where I want to go, you know, like, what would you say that was?
I would say there was a solid, like when I was smoking all that weed, I got real paranoid.
Yeah.
And, I would say the moment right there is when I locked myself in that room and I literally wrote, I started asking myself all the hard questions. Like, what type of man do I want to be? How do I want to carry myself? Who do I want to be overall? You know, what do I want to do? What do I want to give? And so I think once I was in that room, like locked in there and just writing everything, I saw the journal and, I think once I wrote everything down and I started asking myself all those hard questions that a lot of us like ignore for the most part, you know, once I asked myself all those questions, that's when I was like, all right, this is what I'm going to do. Yeah.
What do you think was the hardest part on the journey as far as like to where you're at right now? Like the thing that you had to overcome, the biggest demon that you fought in this business, like just growing as a business owner.
Yeah, I would say my own laziness more than anything. It's literally a struggle every time, you know, I'm like, I want to do all this. I have these big dreams, but yeah. I don't have the actions. So the biggest demon was fighting myself on how to get myself to do it.
How'd you get yourself out of that? Like towards where it was like, now I'm taking action. Because I'm sure that you're not the only one, by the way, because there's a lot of people that are watching this right now that are still stuck in analysis paralysis. They've listened to all. This is episode 78. By the way, this is also my last episode of 32. I'm turning 33 tomorrow.
Congrats.
I appreciate it, man. Thank you. I've lived.
I saw your post this morning. 33 is like the prime number.
It is, man. Yeah. There's so many things that are imperative about that number. And so this is something that I've been waiting for a long time. And so I'm excited because I feel like this is going to be me at my peak state, right? Mm-hmm. But there are a lot of people that listen to this show, Josh, mm-hmm. and they're still just listening to this show. They don't fucking go out and do anything. As a matter of fact, they're like in analysis paralysis right now, you know? Yeah. How did you get over that laziness, you know, and then finally being able to a point where you're like taking action consistently?
I would say the biggest thing is you got to be sick of yourself. You have to be utterly sick of yourself. I was so tired of who I was. I was like literally like depressed. I was looking at myself. I'm like, man, I'm a piece of shit, like honestly.
Fuck.
So I was like, all right, like
self-realization.
Yeah. A lot of self-realization and being, I guess, once you're tired enough of something,
yeah.
I got so tired of the poverty. I got so tired of all this laziness. I got so tired of like looking at all these people on YouTube, learning all this stuff, analysis paralysis, right? Just looking at everybody do all these things and not doing anything myself. So I was like, you know what? I might not know everything. I mean, I know a lot already, right? But I don't know everything. And instead of like trying to figure out everything before I even start, why don't I just start and then figure it out? And then that's kind of what happened with the business.
Dude, I'm just blown away, Josh. Man, guys, you know, this guy right here is a pure testimony of what resilience looks like, one. And two, really just doing what they need to do to get further in life. And I swear, man, I mean, that's the hardest step for anybody that gets into business. Yeah. I remember when I first got in my journey, bro, like the hardest thing for me to get over was stopping drinking alcohol. Like I needed to stop drinking alcohol. I knew for a fact that was one of the things that was holding me back. Now I know maybe you don't deal with an alcohol problem. Maybe you know somebody who is really just calm when they drink, right? But for me, man, I had a very addictive personality that wasn't being channeled into the right things. And so alcohol is where I channeled that addictive personality. I wanted to be great at everything. And so I chose that to be great at alcohol. And so I would just drink, playing drinking games, trying to see who can outdrink me. I'd chug, take shots. And it was a competition with other people that were also ruining their lives, man. And I had a friend, guys, and his name's Freddie Garza. He passed away of COVID. He was 500 pounds when he died. But, you know, he was such an amazing soul. Granted, he was Samoan, but he had a bad drinking problem, bro. He had a bad drinking problem. He and I would meet all the time and we'd have a drinking competition whenever we were in the same room. Who can kill a bottle faster? Who can chug from the bottle? Who can do different things? And we'd just get stupid, man. So like, you know, having an addictive personality is not a bad thing. It's just a gift that has to be channeled correctly. Otherwise, you could bury yourself into something that's toxic. A lot of you guys might be addicted to porn. You might be addicted to videos on the internet. You might be addicted to listening to this podcast. Now, don't get me wrong. I love that you guys are addicted to something that's benefiting you, right? But there got to come a point in your life where you become addicted to action. Because once you start taking action and you start doing all of the things that are bettering yourselves and you rechannel that addictive focus into something that you know is going to make you a better man, a better woman, a better father, a better husband, a better person for your family. Once you're able to do that, that's when the big changes happen, you know? And dude, like literally just blown away by everything that you've been saying, man. And I'm proud of you, dude. I'm proud of you. I got 10 years on you. So I think as a grandpa in the building, yeah. I can say that.
I would say so. You got some more time in the business too.
Yeah, man.
I mean, I've only been doing this since, when did I start that? Probably 2020. So 2 years in.
Dude, I mean, three technically. It's like 2023 now. It's crazy, man. And like I said, brother, I'm proud of you, man. You got such a long way to go, too, and I'm excited to see everything that you're about to do, man. For all of my people that are watching right now, brother, where can they get a hold of you if they want to pick your brain, learn from you, ask you for advice? I know that there's a bunch of kids out there that are your age. I hate to say kid because I'm not that old yet.
Okay,
but
I'm a kid.
Okay, cool. I know that there's some people that are out there that are 22, between 20, 25 that are like blown away by what you just said on this podcast, you know? Where can they follow you, and what's a piece of advice that you would give to that guy that's watching right now that wants to be in your shoes making these plays?
Yeah, so a good place to find me is on Instagram. I'm not that active, but it's Josh Garcia Official, and that's where you can find me on Instagram. Hit me up, send me a DM. Also, I'm looking for a videographer. I need to film an ad. So if anyone is interested, I need to blow up my e-commerce business. So that's an opportunity for somebody. Word of advice is you got to get sick of yourself. That's it. You know, if you're not sick of yourself, then you're going to stay where you are.
I love it, man. Thank you so much, Josh, for being on the podcast. Guys, thank you all for tuning in. I'll catch y'all on the next one. Let's get it.